Okay. Let's look again. Let's fix that. Okay. Okay, I think we're fine. I think we're ready. Hello, everybody. Welcome back. We will be doing Seders today once more. We go down the Seder. Let me close that. It was a problem from the previous stream. So we go back to the Book of Seders. We don't need that. Let's me close that. And we'll be working inside Godot anyway. So do I have anything here open that I don't need? No, I don't think so. So for those that are new to the stream, hello, my name is Dimitris, and also known as Kilon. We are working with Godot, and we're working with Seders, and we're trying to find out how Seders work and how they function. Again, Seders are something you run on your GPU. It can be divided by between vertex and fragment Seders. The vertex Seders are working with vertices, and the fragment Seders working with pixels. So last time we did, why I have to mute? Two mesh instances. So that is the, I made the sphere, so just to compare that. We don't need the sphere, let's remove that. Now this is a shader we created last time. It's a really nice shader. Where is it? Here it is. And here's the code for it. Most of it is actually comments than the actual code. So this is a fragment shader we were working last time. So that is how it looks in real time. So you can see it's semi-transparent. And you can do pretty nice tricks using shaders. And we're trying to figure out, let me precise that, and we're trying to figure out how to use that to our advantage for rendering terrain. In this case, in my case, I want to just make the terrain. I probably will be working more on vertex shaders, but right now, I'm working with fragment shaders because, you know, whatever you do in the fragment shaders are pretty much very similar workflow when you're working with vertex shaders. So let me clear my white dirt here. So that's about it, what we doing last time. We're doing also some basic shapes like boxes and, well, we can't show that. So this one is the wave pattern. So let's go and find... what was the other shaders we done? We did the change color shader. Wait, why doesn't update? Change color. Okay, wait. Sometimes we have to do it from here, yeah. So quick load. We had the linear gradient shader. That's not the linear gradient. That's the box. I don't know. Maybe if I messed up with the loads. So I probably override some files. Let's see what else we have. The change color. That's not also correct. What happened to my files? Did I override everything? Oh yeah. So yeah, we have done many different shaders in the previous time. If I didn't override, what the hell? Yeah, I have override everything. How is this possible? Yeah, I messed things up completely. Yeah. Okay, this one is pretty much... So this is a line you can make. So anyway, this is the shaders we worked in the last time. I have messed up with my saves, obviously. That's fine. We're going to move to the next one anyway. So let's see what is the next one. So we're doing the shaping function, the color, the saves matrix. Where were we? The shaping functions were it? Was it the same function we did? Let's see. My internet is always slow. So this is the line. We made this one. We made this one. We did this one and this one. I think we did that once. Okay, this is other. We haven't done those ones, but we don't really care. And then we move to the next one. I think we finished with this chapter. We did the colors, I think, as well. Yeah, we definitely did those. I don't think we did those, but we don't really care. So we don't really care about this. Then we go to the shapes, which is the most interesting thing. We did the box. So we did the box, which is this one, which I showed already. We did also the circle here, yeah. And also made it so it actually becomes more, you know, gradient, more white and black. And yeah, like this one, I did this one as well. I did it with that smooth step, now we do it with smooth step. This is the last one we did. And let's see, do we have anything else? Okay, we have this one. So let's go and continue with this. So this one must explain the code here. Yeah, so what the code is doing here is using a medium precision float. This is not something that Godot allows us to do in shaders. And then we basically take the coordinates of the pixel. What fragment means here is pixel. We divide by the resolution, and we divide by resolution to see the proportion to the screen, in essence, how far this goes to the screen. So that basically means it takes a value from 0 to 1, in essence. We define a color of black here, and then we define the distance, I think. So we remap the space here, multiply by 2. What? 2 point? What is that? That I don't understand. This is the stupidity of GLSL. It is a 2.0. It implies that it's a 0 and then removes 1 from it. Why it multiplies by 2 and subtracts 1, though? Okay, it tries to remap it on the minus 1. So wait, if it's minus 1, then multiply by 2 is minus 2. Extracting 1.0, it will be minus 2 again. Minus 1, minus 2. Why it's a 1? So if that is minus 1, and then you multiply it by 2.0, it's going to be minus 2. And then you extract minus 1. Wait, what? Is my math so bad? That makes sense for me. Okay, let's take a look. So it's actually minus 1. Minus 1. Come on. Multiply by 2. 2.02. Let's say 2. It's minus 2. That's correct. And we subtract from that minus 1. Minus 3. So why it says that it remaps to space to minus 1 to 1? What? Maybe it remaps the opposite? Well, I don't understand. So let's say, did it say it explains this line? That I don't understand as a line. Also, why it should be minus 1 in the first place? The ST is a resolution thing. It can never be minus. It's always positive. So this one is going to give us a positive number. This one is going to give us a positive number. I don't understand this. This client code, it makes no sense to me. So from that code here, we don't do anything that will have a form of affecting ST. ST is already calculated using these numbers here, which they're always positive. Frag coordinates are always going to be positive because they are pixel coordinates, so they cannot go negative. Resolution also always going to be positive because resolution also is never negative. Here we actually multiply x by the division of this. So the division of this is going to be y divides the usual resolution x and y. Y divides that. Why we divide that? Why you want to do that? So that also going to never be negative. What it means to divide the x with by the y, though? So this one, dividing the fragment coordinates with the resolution, is going to give us the proportion to the screen. So if you go, if you have, because this is divides basically vectors here. So when you see that, when you have a division of vectors, you have a division of x with x here, and you have the division of y with y. So that's how vectors work in terms of division. So this one basically is going to give us a value from 0 to 1. 0 if it's in the 0 of this resolution, so it's 0, 0. And 1 if it's in the resolution of this resolution, which basically resolution in this case is 1080 by, you know, maybe it's 1920 to 1080, or in this case, I think I was using UV coordinates for a resolution. So it goes again from 0 to 1. Right, so here we're using, I think inside, this is the resolution we're using. We're using UV coordinates, which is 0, 1, because in UVs, it's only 0 to 1. So I think the same can it try to do here as well. It tries to use some kind of UV coordinates for the ST. So, why on earth, the big question there is why the x is divided by y? Why the x is divided by the y? I think the reason why it does that is for making these four boxes. So if you divide the x, y, the x and y, probably that's the reason why it's doing that. Of course, here we have a perfect quad. So you divide 1 by 1. If you divide 10 by 10, it will give you 1. So if you divide a resolution x by resolution y, but the resolution x and the y is exactly the same, so basically you have a quad resolution, so a resolution that's a box where every edge is equal, so that means x equals to y. X equals to y, if you divide x by y, it will give return a 1. So here, the x is multiplied by 1, which means it remains the same value. On the other hand, if the x is not equals with y with resolution, that means the x will be stretched to the axis that has the biggest value. So it actually does like a stretch here, if I'm not mistaken. It tries to stretch it so it fills the aspect ratio of the resolution. That's what I think it does here. However, why it says try to remap the space to minus 1 to 1? I think it means here that it managed to remap the space from minus 1 to 1 as a range. So if we have a value of 1, multiplied by 2 will be 2, minus 1 will be make it 1. However, if we have a value of 0.5, it's going to give us 1 and it's going to go back to 0. 1 is going to be negative. It's going to be negative only if it's 0. So let's say let's look at this. So let's see if it makes sense. I think I start understanding how it works. Where is my calculator? Hello, calculator. Okay, so let's say we have a value, because we said it here already that can have a value of 0 to 1. It cannot have any other value. So let's say that it has a value of 0.2. If we multiply by 2, it's going to be 0.4. If we subtract 1 from it, it's going to go 0.6. So if he has a value of 0, it's going to go and become minus 1. If it has a value of 1, it's going to go and become 1. Because we multiply by 2 and we subtract 1 by it. So it actually keeps it from a range of minus 1 to 1. Now I understand. Okay, now I understand it. So it keeps it in the range of minus 1 to 1, as it says here. Okay, that's fine. And for those who don't really know, a distance field is a field that describes whether something's inside the field or outside the field. So you have a field, let's think of it as a sphere, in essence. So how you calculate whether something's inside it or outside it? So inside it, let me think. Inside it will have a value of minus. Outside it will have a value of positive, if I'm not mistaken. So what is inside will be negative, and what is outside is going to be positive, I think. Let me think. Let's see. Is it saying here? It doesn't say what is inside and outside. I think inside is negative and outside is positive. So this is a distance field, right? What is outside is going to be positive, and what is inside is going to be a negative. I think that's how it works. Or it can be the other way around it, but basically that's how the logic works. So if it has a radius of 1, then the maximum value it can get is minus 1, because I think it usually gets a radius of 1. So minus 1 is the maximum you can have here, but of course you can have values greater than minus something outside it. So let's take a look at the distance field, how they work exactly, because I have to understand those things. Distance fields. Okay. Do I have to be logged in to download that? Properly, yeah. Oh, again, don't have to. Okay, I don't want to download anything. I just want to view it on the online. Okay, so that's a distance field. That's smart. No, I want to be explaining what the hell a distance field is. Okay, let's see. I think Wikipedia has a nice article. Yeah, sine distance functions. This is where the distance fields are. Yeah, so the sign determines whether is what sign? The positive or the negative? Okay, so the function has positive values at the point x inside. It's positive when it's inside all omega. Oh. So it's positive when it's inside and negative when it's outside. So the boundary is 0, correct. And it takes a negative value outside all. Okay. So that's a distance field. Those things are worst. We used in 3D graphics, 2D graphics, fonts, rendering. So the distance fields actually are pretty common. And the function that produces them is called sine distance function. Oh, Oh. Dear buffer. What's wrong with me? Oh, it makes sense. God of the year. In 2020, the first game engine God of War received SDF Best Global Illumination. That became a compromise between more realistic voxel-based global illuminations and baked global illumination. Its core advantage is that it can be applied to infinite space, which allows developers to use for open-world games. Cool. But why I thought that there was a distance field kind of thing. So let's take a look at SDF ray marching, I think it's called. Let's call it. No, I don't want. Well, you know, I can take a look at this guy as well. But I want the Quillus. So this is explaining here the ray marching technique, where you're using some distance fields to trace a ray, in essence. So you can render things piece by piece. So insist that we start. Is the point inside the scene surface? Does the SDF evaluate to a negative number at this point? So what is inside? Wait, what is inside is negative? I thought that what was inside is positive. What, make up your mind, guys. Is it negative or is it positive? So what is inside? We said that should be positive. What says negative? Is it very inside a negative number? So what is inside in this case is negative, and what is outside is positive. So that's how it works. You take the distance here, and as you can see here, it intersects so you take a smaller circle this time. And that circle also intersects here, right? So this one intersects this one. Sorry, this one intersects here. This one intersects here, which is why what defines basically the size. So it actually traces, it makes the circle bigger, 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 until it reaches the first intersection here. So it says this is the first step. Then makes a new circle, makes bigger, 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 and says what I'm intersecting, I'm intersecting here. Then it goes to the next circle, so it uses the next point as the center for radius for the new circle. Bigger, 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 intersects here, then continues to make this circle, makes bigger, bigger, and of course intersects here, and that is basically the surface that it wants to trace. So now exactly knows where it points, and that is the point that it meets there. So you can keep, of course, increasing the steps here, until it makes them more and more specific. But of course, here the circles will become very, very small, and you will become more and more accurate on where the point really lies. Because as you can see here, the point doesn't quite sit on the surface. So you may have to continue this process a bit. So that is basically the ray marching technique for rendering scenes. Where the ray tracing technique is just a single line that hits the surface and reflects from there. So it's a bit different. Here you move into steps made of circles. And that is ray marching. Now, why we care about ray marching? Well, ray marching is a rendering technique, so it allows us to do a bit more higher resolution graphics than ray tracing. I think ray marching difference probably is that it's not as noise prone. I'm not sure about this, but I think with ray tracing you have noise. With ray marching you need less rays to trace surfaces. They are more accurate when it comes to tracing surfaces. So you don't need as many rays. And you can have, it doesn't create as much noise in the rendering result. But you can do ray marching to use it for various reasons that we'll be using here. Collision detection, you can use it for global illumination like Godot is doing. You can use it for creating fonts, for rendering vector images, for rendering 2D images. There's quite a lot of usages for ray marching and science distance fields, because ray marching goes together with the science distance fields functionality. Obviously, to do that, it has to check through every single surface and every single point of that surface against the distance from the radius. So it still makes checks, a lot of checks, which makes it expensive. Instead of just firing a random ray, letting it hit the surface, and then checks if that array hits that specific surface. Here, we don't check the array against whether it actually hits a specific surface, whether the circle we create with this ray hits the surface. So it's a bit different workflow. It's not quite the same with ray tracing. But the code is still pretty simple. It is a bit much. Yeah, this is a sphere without shading. And I think it's also very easy to get the normals. Okay, from inside the surface goes negative, outside goes positive. And this is how you get the normals from an SDF. And this is one of the main way we do actually the SDFs. We use basically Booleans. And you can see here it has infinite detail. There's no polygons. So that's the power of SDFs, that they don't really are polygon based. You have basically an infinite amount of detail. They are the equivalent of vector graphics for 3D, as I call them usually. And that means also you don't get the same amount of performance though. And that can be a bit of an issue. But I'm not excluding the fact that I may be doing the game in SDFs, in Ray Martin SDFs. Maybe I will do it also like that. I don't think it's necessarily a bad idea, because I will be using a 2070 Super GPU, which kind of reach 60 frames per second from what I've seen. So maybe we'll do that like that as well, or at least make some of the graphics like that. I don't know it yet. But all this happens inside the shader, right? So this is completely shader driven. So I want to do this tutorial at some point, but not now. Not now. What is this here? Yeah, this is SDFs. No, I want... Let's see what other help it has. Okay. No, let's go to 3D SDFs. No. What's it? There was an article about SDFs. So this is a distant field where everything inside is negative and everything outside is positive. Okay. So you, here you can see how he actually makes the complex shape after simple STFs that combine together. Okay, so that is ray marching. Wait, it says very much in the race. So yeah, this is going to be our work for the next few months. We'll try to understand all these things that are pretty dense for me now. I'm trying to. I'm also be studying linear algebra on the sides, trying to understand how vectors work, matrices, and all this kind of stuff. So yeah, there's going to be a lot of study with these things. But for now, let's go back to the book of shaders and go back to this code. So we know how this works, okay. And then we take the length of, why it's 0.3 though? Why it subtracts 0.3 there? And why it's, okay, it's always 0.3. Why extract 0.3 from that? Why not have something? Okay, let's take a look at the shader here. Let me open wave patterns. So what happens if I go here and go with, 0.5. So I think that basically repositions the distance field. What if I go 1.0? Okay, so that puts the distance field on the corners. And what if I put it on 0.0? Okay, so now that reposition. Okay, I get it now. Okay, so it basically tries to offset the field distance field. So it's actually reflected in this case. 0.3. Actually, what happens if I put it on 3.0? What happens? That's probably nothing. Oh, well, what's the difference with 1.0? Okay, so it does still scale them. Okay, so let's keep it at 0.3. As a matter of fact, we do that. No, we don't do that here. We take the minimum. Minimum between and zero. The minimum between zero. So if you take the minimum, why taking the minimum here matters though? Okay, let's take a look at the code again. Why taking the minimum here matters? So it filters the zero out. So it turns this into a, it turns this to a positive. It subtracts 0.3 from it. So it can go negative again. And takes the minimum. I don't understand this code. I don't understand this code. Oops. What is that? So it takes the length, which is always with the distance field, you take the length. It takes, it strips the sign from the AST, which we do here as well. Okay, but the one thing I understand is why we strip the sign. Why we strip the sign? If the distance field has to have a sign for positive and negative. So why we do that? I think we do that because it doesn't want to make the distance field be... So what happens if I remove the ABS? Okay, let's say I remove the ABS, right? And do that. What happens? Okay, that definitely creates a problem. So that is the distance field by itself, which has been outplaced. If you remove that, it's going to give us this full distance field, which is that, of course. So that basically offsets the distance fields a bit. And then we do an OBS with this one. Is this the correct code? Yeah, that's the correct code. Okay. And this one is what? A different shape. So we take the max here. So it's the same code as previously, instead of min, it's a max. So min is this shape. I don't understand why that is the case, though. And max is this shape. So in this case scenario, if we strip that and we subtract that, so if it's minus 1, it's going to be 1. Subtract by 0.3 is going to be 0.7. So the max value there is going to be 0.7. In the previous example, the max value will be 0. The value will be written 0 because it returns the minimum value, which is always going to be 0. Because that is going to be positive. The only case where those things will be... No. It always return this value in the case of min, right? Because the value can never be negative, so the maximum value can have is 1, and that means the maximum value we can get here is 0.7, correct? And it's going to return the minimum value, which is going to be 0. So it's going to filter everything up to 0.7. Actually, going to filter everything. The only value is not going to filter, well, it's going to be, so it only returns 0 then. If that's the case, because 0 is always going to be the minimum value, right? Let's take a look at the mix and max. I think that's what the mix and max does. Okay, let's take a look at the mix and max again to be certain that I don't CLSL mean. So mean means what? So mean returns the lesser of two values. Okay, so that's pretty much self-explanatory. And max returns the bigger of the both values. So, in this case, the ST is always going to be, actually, it is the ST. Oh, so ST is a vector. ST is not a number, a float, it's a vector. I see. So, when you subtract one vector from another, shouldn't it be a vector subtracted by a vector? So this one is a vector, right? ST is a vector. A 2D vector. And if we subtract 0.3, then... Yeah, so this guarantees that... So basically this guarantees that we'll always get the maximum value here. So that means, in this case, if I'm not mistaken, that we can have a negative value here. So a negative length, which makes sense because we want our length to be negative because we make a science distance field. So the distance has to be either positive or it has to be negative. But we strip the sign here. However, because we subtract 0.3, that basically means that values that are below 0.2 will have a negative result. If it's 0.3 and we subtract 0.3 from it, it's going to be 0. So it's going to be 0, this other actually extracts. But if it's 0.2 or 0.1, we're going to have a 0.1 or 0.2, negative 0.1 or negative 0.2. Which means it's going to return a negative here. In this case, however, which is the max, which is doing the same thing, it will never get the negative because it will get the maximum of compared to zero. For something to be greater than something like zero, it will always be positive. So that doesn't mean that this here is always pick something that's negative. Oh, I get it now. So here it gets always the negative value, the negative values. So it filters here and gets only the negative values, where here it only gets the positive values, which is why it compares with zero. But why that changes the shape of the distance field, though? Because we see here there's a change in the distance field, which I don't understand. So here we have a positive distance field, and why it's square? Shouldn't be the distance will be circular. So let's say we remove that. What happens? Do we get a circle? Oh, you get a circle. So why subtracting from the distance field forces it to become almost a rectangular shape? Why that happens? So let's take it more gradually. Okay, why that's happened? It must have to do with something. No, because here, wait, the length is used for, D is used where? For the fractal. Visualize the distance field. So here it uses the fractal. So let's say you have a 3 here and we don't use a fractal. What happens in this case? What happens if we don't use a fractal? So we have fract. No, we do it by 10. So we'd say that's D. Okay. So the fractal basically tends a fraction of our values, which is why it actually has, okay, so let's go back to where the call was. So if that's the case, that basically means that this one is creates the size, the length that snaps to. So let's say that we make that smaller, so that one should make everything blurrier. If we do 2, it should make the lines thinner. Oh no, it doesn't. So it makes them, it basically mirrors them in some kind of way. So that means that if I go 100, it should be a lot denser. Okay. And now we see a different visualization of it, or maybe also a distortion. Yeah, that is a distortion. We have to zoom in to see exactly how the field is. Yeah. So that's a view distortion because of aliasing, probably. Okay. So that is exactly what it does there. But the one thing I don't understand is why the distance field is shaped like a square when you offset it like that. So here is the basic shape with the offset, right? Which is basically circles, which makes sense. So it's not the offset that creates the problem. I think I understand that. So actually creates the average there because, oh, okay, I get it now. Because it the distance field, actually it's not one distance field, it's 4 distance fields. If I understand this correctly. Or it's at least it's a quad distance field or something like that. Because we already offsetting like that, which is, makes sense why it's perfectly circle when we do a 0 here. Because it mirrors it in essence. So in essence, it mirrors it, which then you use the min and max to basically average it. It's like smoothing out the distance field. So basically here we smoothing out the distance field. But why? And we reverse it. So that is like a mirror on a negative axis. And then you go here and you do like a positive thing, which is a bit goes a max. So you basically flip it. So min was basically flipping it the other way. Okay, let's go back and see again the first one. Okay, so the min and max has this kind of effect that actually smooths things up here. So we reach up to here, which is basically what? It's like one third along the way. Let's see what happens in this case, which is interesting. So that is actually a lot closer. Okay, I cannot say I understand the distance fields very well in this case scenario. I'm still pretty much perplexed by them, how they work exactly, and why that actually works the way it works. But again, my math knowledge is pretty limited. So we know what the fract is doing here. It takes a fraction of the value, so it doesn't visualize the entire value, it only visualizes every 10 values. Something like that, if I'm not mistaken. Because I think that's what happens here. It takes a fraction of the value, in essence. So let's take a look at what fract is doing exactly, so we don't talk generally and, yeah. And, yeah, whatever. So a fract computes the fractional part. The fractional, computes the fractional, oh, so that's something different then. The fractional part of the argument, fractional part, which means what? So it's some kind of calculation of a fraction. Okay, I have no idea what that means, but okay. Let's see if we find any other documentation that's more, yeah, so a fract. That's the Book of Shaders. Okay, so it took us back to full circle where we were. So a fract computes the fractional part of the argument. Floor X. What the floor is it doing exactly? Floor, okay, so floor finds the nearest integer less or equal to the parameter. The less integer, but it returns a float. But if it's an integer, so it snaps to an integer, so it's like a snapping function. Okay, so I understand what it means now. What it does here, it returns steps. It returns only offsets that are snapped to a unit function. So it returns the actually offsets. Instead of returning 0.1, 0.2, 0.2, 2.5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, it returns values like 1, 1, fractions only fractions. So how exactly... Okay, I kind of understand why it works. Okay, I'm not understanding fully how it works, but kind of understand why it works. Okay, so we finished with understanding this one. The next one we have to do now is gonna go to. We finished with this one. I will not say that I know everything about it. And we haven't done this one actually. Or we have done it. No, we haven't done these things here. So let's take a look at this as well. And have actually created it. I have actually commented out what I have done. Oh, actually have. Okay, so I assume that this should be removed. And I have to go, okay, let me zoom in and remove those. Let's see what changes here. Okay, so that's one step of the distance field, I assume. What is that? Another step, so that visualizes, so it uses the distance field to visualize specific parts of it. Yeah, this is a smooth step, basically creates a smooth result. So what happens if I open this one? Probably it will override it. Yeah, it overrides it. Okay, so this means that only one of those have to be visualized. Okay, we have to be uncommented. Okay, so I'm gonna take a small break and I will be back in 5 minutes. See you then. And we are back. We are back. So, let me look here. Okay. And we're going to be moving to the next okay, let me close that. We're going to be moving to the next example. Because the sun distance field is something I have to understand. I don't fully understand them. I kind of, you know, I figure things out, have a very basic idea what they are, but we're going to be coming to this subject again and again and again. So let's move to the next one. So let's say what he says here. We start by moving the coordinate system to the center and shrinking it in half. And we're shrinking it in half in order to remap the position values between, we're shrinking in half in order to remap the position values between minus 1 and 1. Also, on line 24, we are visualizing the distance field using fract function, make it easy to see the pattern they create. The distance field patterns repeats over and over like rings in a Zen garden. Let's take a look at the distance field formula in line 19. There, we're calculating the distance to the position on 0.3 by 0.3, which is why it uses only one scalar number. In all four coordinates, that's what ABS is doing there. So wait, the ABS makes the coordinates, the quadrants? The ABS that makes the quadrants? Interesting. Okay, so the ABS is making the coordinates. This thing here, it makes in the coordinates. Okay, let's test this theory. I think it's actually correct, yeah, because we're testing them previously, and that's exactly what happened. Yeah, so the ABS makes the coordinates. Okay. So yeah, why the ABS makes the coordinates though? That I don't really understand. Why the ABS makes the coordinates, in the quadrants? So why the ABS divides by 4 in essence, and mirrors by 4, or mirrors by 4 in this case? That for me doesn't make much sense, because it removes the sign. So I think the problem with the sign is that you can have a sign. No, it doesn't make any sense. I'm trying to understand how it works exactly, but I don't. So let's explore the distance field formula in line 19. There we are calculating the distance to the position, blah, blah. It's for all four corners. That's what ABS is doing there. If you uncomment the line 20, you will notice that we combine the distance to these four points using mean zero. So the mean is actually combine the distances. Combine the distance. So when combine things, they smooth out by default. Now, trauma and commenting, well, we are doing the same, but the magnetic result is a triangle with a random corners. Now, how the rings of distance get smoother the further away they get from the center. They get smoother the further away they get. Finish and comment. Okay. So, I don't quite understand it. If he actually explained why the ABS makes the corners, will be nice. Wait, what? What is that? That's not the... What? I think I fucked up the coding. So anyway, let's go to the polar shapes. Okay, this is going to be a polar thing. Okay. So it does the same thing here, subtracts 0.5. So if you subtract 0.5, you take something to the center and centrally, because the maximum value it gets usually is 0 to 1. And multiplies by 2. So this one gets the polar coordinates. Okay. So that is for making something polar. Okay. Okay, so let's try. I'm not going to port this because, you know, it's the same thing for what? Oh, okay. Sorry, my bad. So you have to, and then you have to what? Okay. 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 How the hell is doing that? Smooth step. Okay, use the smooth step. Cosine and sine. So I have no idea how those things really work exactly, to be frank about it. But that's a nice way to make a gear. So the polar coordinates basically rotate everything around the center, around the circle here. And it's like works like an array in Blender, it's like a circular array in Blender in essence. So this is the coordinates, and then obviously applies a sine wave on that. I think that's the sine wave it uses, because that's a sine wave, and then shapes the sine wave a cosine in essence. So the cosine is like a sine wave, but it's a as we said, the sine wave, I think, was the x-axis of the circle, and cosine was the y-axis of the circle. And multiplies by 10. So let's play around with that. Let's multiply by 12. Let's multiply by 16. Okay, so here it defines how many edges it has on the gear. So this is actually how we make procedural geometry, right? So this is 2D shape, but you can apply that in 3D shapes. So if you want to have more spikes on your gear, you just increase the number here, and that's about it. Or you decrease it and make like 3 only, right? So now you don't have a gear, but you have like another thing, like device or instrument, right? And if you extrude this in 3D space, you're going to have a 3D shape essentially. So what we do here as 2D, we can apply the same notions for 3D, just by extruding and just by, you know, using 3D coordinates. So right now we're using only 2D coordinates. So this is 2, this is 1, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, come on. Okay, so it was 3, I think. Oh, no, was it? What was it exactly? It wasn't 19. I think it was 10. And then we have this. I think this is where the shape actually takes place. Wait, what? No. So this shape has to be, let's make it 3. Okay, so here's the extrusion of the shapes, of the spikes. Okay. So that we can use it now to make like a sun or something, or like a propeller. So you can use that to make like a propeller. And this is what exactly? That must be the space between them, if I'm not mistaken. You don't do what you don't want to do. No, actually, it's the general size. Actually, it's not this, it's the size of the center. So, how I can make it? Okay, what about this? What about this is... No, this probably it will relocate the entire thing because I fixed the coordinates there. Right? No, actually it rescales the entire thing. Okay. So, what about this? Oh, yeah. Here it is. Okay, so this is actually smoothest out because the part of the smooth step. Yeah, you can actually smooth out the result completely. Okay, so what happens if I change that to 0.2? Oh, I get it now. So this is where you control the smoothing. Nice. So and one is going to do a standard smoothing. Okay. So the one thing I want to find out is how exactly you could maybe change the so you have an A here. What is the A exactly? An atom. So an atom, maybe affecting the atom here by 10. So the 10 we said here is the amount of, which makes sense, is going to be the frequency. So it's going to be the amount of spikes you're going to have. So this is actually affects the frequency here. So it's the amount of spikes. So how we can actually make it so it has, I would like to reduce the space here. How do I do that? So what about this cosine here? But it overrides it. So that shouldn't really affect anything, right? Because it doesn't really take the existing F value. It just overrides on top of that. I'm just wondering. So this is the color only. We don't really care about the color. So it's FF plus 02. Let's see. Well, let's take a look at this as well. Yeah, this must be a way to do a way to do basically, yeah, a blur effect. So I think it was that. So you have like a smoothing effect, like an idealizing effect. Okay, so how exactly I can make the triangle, the things inside here more wide? How can I do that? I don't know. Anyway, just okay. I don't know. That's a math. Mathematical knowledge is very limited there. So let's play around with this argument as well. Oh yeah, okay, that's most probably scaling this up, I assume. Let's make it 3. Let's see what happens if it's 3. Yeah, probably scales it. I fix the scaling. What about minus 0? Oh, don't, okay. Haha, okay, I didn't expect that. So let's see, minus 1. So it plays around with the polar coordinates here. Okay, so as you can see here, this is how you can do those things. You always affect the shaders, and you always change and morph things from one thing to another. Look at this. This I created the tooth. And we have our first bot band. Let's make sure that the bot bands the right people. Let me change that again. The bot so far hasn't had any problems for banning other bots. So I don't think it failed this time. Nope, it didn't fail. It's what was a bot that was trying to advertise us some spam site. So where we were? I think we're here, right? Yeah. So okay, so this one is my doing. What about this one? 0.3. So that is on the y-axis, rotation on the y-axis. Okay, well, I will figure things out one day. I'm pretty sure about it. Right now, I have no idea what I'm doing. I will be honest about this. But that's fine. So that we learn how to modulate the radius of the circles according to the angle using the ATAN to draw different shapes. We can learn how to use ATAN with distance fields and apply all the tricks and effects possible with distance fields. The trick will use the number of edges of a polygon to construct the distance field using polar coordinates. Check out the following code from Andrew Balding. It makes ABS function makes negative numbers positive, which I know. It reflects them around zero. Oh yeah, I get it now. And because you are, okay, I get it now why ABS makes quadrants. Because it reflects them around zero, that means you reflect them around zero on the x-axis, but because we have a vector, it's an x and a y-axis. So it reflects on x-axis and reflects on the y-axis, which basically means it mirrors on the x and the y, which makes the quadrant. Okay, now that makes sense. Okay, now I understand it. Why the ABS is, if we actually did the ABS only on the x-axis, we had only one thing, two mirrors. So if I go back here and do an ABS on only the x-axis, so I say that ABS let's say that I make the, let's say vector vec2, and I make ABS only the x-axis, and then I take the HTY without ABS in it. Oh, yeah. So now I don't have a reflection. Well, actually, it will make more sense if I do it like where? I should have done it up here, which is the first visualization, but that's fine too. So we see here, it doesn't reflect on the x-axis, so we don't have the mirroring, so which is why it works like that. Okay, I get it now. So ABS basically mirrors because it forces to snap on the zero axis, on the zero for both axes. Okay, so that makes sense. So, oh, wait. No, in this case, we don't really max the Ry and Rx. So here, he actually takes the max of the both axes, which is not the same. So here, it's going to give us a square. And you use the step. So we used the step function previously for doing that with circles. So that's no surprise there. That's no surprise there. So use smooth step to make things smoother. So what exactly the ATAN is doing? GLSL ATAN. So the ATAN is doing what? Return the arctangent of the par arctangent. What is this arctangent? What the hell is an arctangent? So what is the tangent exactly? The ATAN function is a number request that equalize the value in radians of the angle whose tangent equals a specific number, the inverse of the tan function. In the diagram below, the arc tangent of BA is x. So basically calculates the angle. The attraction is number that calculates the value of the angle in radians. So basically it's a BA and you find the x angle there. So yeah, so you multiply by 100 APS. So radians basically is how many times one radian is one radian, I think, is a full circle, if I'm not mistaken. So one radian is it? Let me think. No, I think one radian is, I think it's a full. No, I think it's the radius of the circle as a perference. So you need 3.14 radians to make a circle. So no, you need 3.14. You need pi amount of radians to do a circle, circumference, how it's called. Sorry about my English, but sometimes it fails me. But you need a pi, so which is why it defines 180 by pi to find the degrees, the difference in degrees. So so here you have an edge A and you have an edge B, and you want to find the angle here when they meet. So where is there they meet? Given the lengths, right? You know the length here, you know the length here. If you don't really know that, if you know this and this, you can find that from Pythagorean theorem and vice versa. So as long as you have two edges, you can find the B and A. And then you can calculate the x, which is going to be the tangent in this case. So it gives you this edge. And it's important to remember here that if we have, because here we have, I don't know if that should work, it does work only for orthogonic triangles. In this case, we can actually find also the angle of this, because we know that the triangle has 180 degrees of total angles. So the triangles are always 180 in the total angles they have if you add them together. So if you have 90, so this one has to be, this one and this one has to equals to 90 as well. It doesn't have to be orthogonal though. Does it? Does it need to be orthogonal for this to work? For a tan to work? I don't think so. But then tangent usually are something that is pretty flat, pretty perpendicular to, but I don't think so. Whose tangent, this is what I understand, calculates the value of the angle whose tangent equals a specific number. Whose tangent. Okay, let's take a look at the tan function then. The tan function calculates the tangent of an angle in the right triangle, the side opposite that right triangle. What is a right triangle? A right triangle. What the hell is a right triangle? So in right triangle or right angle triangle, or more formally orthogonal triangle. So this works only for orthogonal triangles. So it's an orthogonal triangle. So orthogonal means that there's one side is 90 degrees, two sides are 90 degrees angled. So that's what it means, right? That's probably orthogonal. Is the opposite of in a right triangle, the opposite the side opposite an angle divided by the side adjacent to the angle. Oh. So tangent is basically the side opposite the angle, which is B, divided by the side adjacent to the angle, which is A. B to A, B divided by A. Okay, so it's the proportion of one side to another. And atangent is the opposite. So the tangent takes... so tangent is a proportion. Okay, I get it now. So here it takes the arc tangent. So we have the tangent already. And the tan function calculates the value and it returns the angle. Where here, we do not take the angle at all. We just calculate the tangent. No, we use the tangent here to return the angle. Where here, we don't really use the angle at all. Okay, I think I get it. Maybe. So, okay, where we were. No, close that. And go back here. So a tan basically means angle tangent. So what we use here, we use a tan, so it returns an angle. And x and y is the sides that it uses. But wait, a tan takes as an input a tangent. How the hell? So a tangent must be a number, right? Wait. No, actually it takes a vector. Specify the numerator of the fraction where specify the numerator of the fraction whose arctangent to return the numerator of the function. So then the denominator of the function whose tangent to return. What? The coordinate that the angle lies in. The coordinate. I don't understand, man. Shit. I don't understand. The value returned by a tan is in this case is in the range. What? I don't know. Just no idea. Okay, so let's say it returns a freaking angle. Okay. And it takes the y and the x plus pi, plus pi. Why adds pi there? Is that what we were doing previously? No, we didn't. Here we take only the atan without adding pi to it. Why we add pi to it? And then we have a 2 pi. What the hell is a 2 pi? Is that the global? Oh, here it is. So it's 2 as the pi, in essence. So it's 2 pi divided by float n, which n is what? 3. So I think 2 pi is basically the full circle. I don't know. So what happens if I use a pi there? It's going to be too upset? Okay. So it doesn't like that. So 2 pi and float n, which is 3. So how many sides is of your shape? What if I have 4? Ooh, what if I have 5? Oh, 6. Oh, 7. Oh, 9. Oh. Okay. Okay. I no idea what you're doing here, man. I really have no idea what you're doing. Okay. So, shaping the function that modulates the distance. What the hell is that? Okay, let's take a look at the comments, the description. So, use an example, make a function and inputs the position and number of mixed distance together with min and max. Just take a break and let this concept fill in. So, you don't explain it at all. Nope. Just you throw a pi there and whatever happens, happens, right? Shaping function that modulates the distance. Do we have that? The shaping function modulates distance early on? No. Nothing. Nada. So here we had the D. Okay, let me reload that because I think I messed up the code there. Okay, that wasn't very helpful. Okay. I have no idea what most of these things are, to tell you the truth. But whatever. So we know that IBS basically creates a mirror on X and Y axis we want to, if we pass the vector. We know what ATAN is. We know what distance fields are. We understand the length. The length is a basic property of the distance field. I'm not one certain 100% about the fract here. It does takes a fracture and only takes the step, the value of the steps, of the values returns, which is a piece of the value itself. And then we draw the polar shapes. We use the ATAN here to get the polar coordinates. So it basically does a calculation around a circle, so it moves in a circular fashion using the ATAN function. So I can understand those. Yeah, I vaguely understand them, right? I'm not by any means have a good understanding of how they work in practice because I'm completely clueless when it comes to trigonometry. So here, I don't understand this so well. We take the ATAN, okay, so I get it now. We want to get the angle, so this is going to return the angle of ST, Y, and ST, X. I imagine here that X, basically the ATAN here works by taking one side and the other, but here our triangle is not a right triangle by any means. So what am I missing here? And what the plus pi is used for. So let's remove that. What happened? It doesn't like the fact that I haven't added the semicolon. So the pi basically rotates the angle. What? It seems that it rotates the angle. So flips it. So, okay, so the pi, the return is actually in radians. So if we add the pi, okay, let's take a look at it a bit differently. So let's say that we add the pi divided by 2. So what happens if I, maybe 2.0, okay. Don't upset about it. 2.0, 2.1, 2.2, 2.3. Okay, so let's say 0.5 then. 0.5. So 0 is going to be here. What? Wait, what? White circle. Ah, because we divide by 0. 0.1, 0.2, 0.3, 4, 5. Wait, let me do that. 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So this is that's the rotation in essence. Really. So a pi gives, yeah, because a circle is usually 2 pi. A circle is 2 pi. So if we do a 2 pi, it will take, so basically without pi is like that. With actually, let's multiply 0.0 by pi is that. But if I do it 2 times, it will return back to the same position. And it's the same position. So a full circle is 2 pi in essence. A full circle is 2 pi for the rotation. Where here, in 1 pi, is going to be half the rotation. So it's going to flip it. So it flips. 1.5 is going to take it almost to a full flip. So here we almost flipped again back to where we were. And 2 pi goes 360 degrees rotation. And that rotates around itself in essence. So that's what the pi really does here. So here it basically rotates it so it appears upside down. So that is what it does in this case. But I don't understand why it goes here. I think what it does here is trying to convert the radians to a degree angle. Maybe? Because if you divide 180 by, or 2 pi, which is the first circle, but 180, which is the n. So let's say we do 180. What happens if we do 180? It should give us a full circle, which is the case. So if you divide 2 pi by 180, because 2 pi represents a full circle, it gives you something that's 180 degrees, which means that it gives you the full circle. If you do it 3 times, it will basically take only 3 values from that circle. So it's going to divide by 3. It's going to take 1, 2, 3 values only if we go into an entire circle like that. So basically, it adds the values. Those are the corners here that we find. The points here are nothing more than points on a circle. So this is why it calls this polar coordinates in essence. Because every value we take here is basically nothing more than points on a circle. So this 2 pi divided by 4, yeah, is going to take according to our circle in essence. So, okay, we understand that. This one's going to give us the angle. But what it does gives us? It gives us which angle, actually? It gives us the angle of X and Y. Does it give us the angle for every single thing? So basically from what we see here, we get in a triangle that has equal angles. So if I do it at 4, we get again equal angles. So that basically gives us a square. If we do a 5, again, do I get equal angles? I think I'm still getting equal angles, if I'm not mistaken. 6, so I always going to get equal angles in every single case, which, if I'm not mistaken, it gives us always 180 as an addition, because we know that the triangle will always have 180 as a total value for if you add all angles together. That applies, of course, to the square, because the square has only orthogonal angles, which means it has only 40 degrees, 90 degrees angles, which is, 45 degrees. Wait, what? The square has what? 45. No, it's not 45, it's 90. So it has, it's 90, isn't it? 180 is this one. 360 is the entire thing, so this is 180. So this one is 90. So it's not 180 in total. No, it's actually wrong. That's wrong. This is actually 270 in this case. So 180 is a circle. So Anyway, so, okay. So, that is basically here is doing what? Why we need this? We need this because we're shaping function that modulates the distance. That I don't understand. This actual part is not that I don't understand. This one is, I kind of get this one. I kind of get this one because this one returns the angle. This one is returns us, I think, the degrees. Even though it has R, I think the degrees here. Or it is angle and radius. It says that it actually returns here the radius. The radius from the current pixel. What it means by radius? I don't understand that. So it returns the radius. I don't understand this at all. I don't know what it means by radius here. Why it needs the radius? So 0.5 plus radius divided by angle divided by radius. And then you have the radius subtracts the angle. I don't understand how this works. What is doing here? Not at all. So let's play around with this. Actually, let's use that. What the hell? Okay. That's weird. Okay. Okay. Okay, this is the color. It's going to be a smooth step. Let's see. Yeah, that's going to be the result I expected. And what about this one? What? Why this one affects the color? It must be the color. Okay. Okay. Right. Okay. So I'm going to take another break, guys. You know, just walk my legs a bit. And we'll be back in 10 minutes. See you then. So I'm back. I will probably end the stream here. I'm kind of tired, so I would like to take a break. Thanks everybody for coming and watching and participating in the stream. And yeah, I will take a break for a couple of hours, 2.5 hours, and then be back and continue with this because I want to clean my head a bit. I'm kind of tired because I've done already a total of 3 hours of streaming. Yeah, and see you then. We have done some basic understanding. The thing about this is that now we have to focus more and more on the mathematical side. So it's not going to be easy. I can understand if people, you know, don't want this kind of things because it's slow, it's very technical, it's very theoretical. But we have to understand how tons work, how circles working, how triangles are working in order to be able to do shader work. Otherwise, all this is pointless. So yeah, I will be doing the grind, and in the next few weeks, I will have to put my head down and keep working on those things. And that was going to be the streams until we start making interesting things like terrains and plants and all this kind of stuff. We have to first learn the basic. We have to understand how trigonometry works, how, you know, to do things with distance fields, how we do with polar coordinates and all this kind of stuff. So in any case, thanks everybody for being here. Thanks for watching. And I will see you again in 2.5 hours. I will be returning and we'll do probably another 2-hour stream and see how we can go from there. Thank you, everybody. Bye-bye.